You'll start. Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am. I'll just give the introduction, ma'am. Good evening, dear members. Today we have yet another interesting and very important session today. So we have none other than Dr. Professor S.R. Chandra, ma'am, retired professor of neurology from NIMHANS, Bangalore, to discuss one of the most commonly seen disorders and commonly seen nerve disease affecting most commonly the facial nerve. So we'll understand the intricacies of the facial nerve, and madam will, as always, demystify and make it a more clinical approach to neurology, which we have all been enjoying throughout the past few months. Over to you, madam.
Okay, thank you. The facial nerve is a smiling nerve, as I have put. As you know, the smile doesn't come from the motor pathways themselves. It comes from the cognitive emotional circuits. So that is why the facial nerve is very important. It's very familiar for you. But I am using this nerve to put you on track regarding how I approach a cranial nerve. Which I would have told during the clinical discussions that every nerve other than the first and the second nerve has got supranuclear, nuclear, intraaxial fascicular, cisternal, skull base, foraminal and soft tissue planes. So the nerve can be involved, all the nerves you have to study like this. This is my template I have been teaching for so many decades. In this template, it's very useful. It will help you to localize. So first and second is different. Other nerves have all these. Every nerve, when you read, it will not be like that. But you should fix a template like this. What are the companies? What are all the features in the supranuclear plane? Second, nuclear plane, intraaxial fascicular, cisternal, skull base, foraminal, soft tissue plane. So each plane, how your particular nerve gets affected, if you have a template, you will know where is that nerve involved. That gives you the etiological causes for the evaluation of that nerve. So this smiling nerve I put like that because once upon a time when I was a student, there was a famous plastic surgeon, Sam C. Bose. He designed a method to mobilize palmaris longus tendon to reconstruct unrecovering old facial palsy and reproduce the smile. So in Madras Medical College, when this thing was being demonstrated, I remember what my teacher said. You can make the person grin only, but smile comes from the brain. So with this, smile cannot be given back to the patient. So that I remember. So we will use this template. All of you know, I don't think you will be learning anything new, except that to travel through how to place a nerve in these planes, which I have just mentioned. So, the way this nerve is very special, even though it's most familiar, it governs emotional expressions as well as motor functions. So, it governs emotional expressions as well as motor functions, and it is concerned with taste, you know, anterior. Two-thirds of the tongue, the caudate tympanic nerve, so taste. So there is expression, there is motor function, there is taste and swallowing. We must have discussed in some of our clinical cases the oral phase of swallowing. The buccinator, orbicularis, oris, they are involved in the oral phase of swallowing. And it is having some autonomic functions, the secretomotor fibers for the greater supervisor, superior salivatory nucleus, the salivary gland, all those things. So it is having autonomic function and it is having sensations also. It is having the sensation over the conga of the ear. So many functions. Grossly, it is a facial nerve, which all of us know, but it is having emotion, it is having motor function, it concerns taste, swallowing, autonomic functions, secretomotor functions, and sensation too. Also vital for human existence. So without all this, we do not exist. So the commonest nerve, which all of us see day in and day out, is so vital for us. So we'll approach this nerve under anatomy, physiology, localization of vessel. Mainly remember the template: supranuclear, nuclear, intraaxial, fascicular, cisternal, scalpel, foraminal, soft tissue plane. How to make the template for all other cranial nerves in your mind? That is what we will learn. No? So this is the planes, which I said. This is applicable to all the cranial nerves: supranuclear, nuclear, intraaxial, fascicular, cisternal, skull base, foraminal, and soft tissue planes. So all these planes, you should know how the nerve palsy will manifest. No? So we'll start with the central control or the supranuclear. For the voluntary face movement, that's a motor component, and eye closure are under control from the lower one third of the precentral gyrus. You know the precentral gyrus, the motor area where you have the homunculus. In the lower part of the precentral gyrus, the facial area. No, I'm audible? Huh? Am I audible? Any problem?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam. You're audible.
No? Because I thought you said something. No? So the voluntary face movements and eye closure are under control from the lower one third of the precentral gyrus in the motor cortex. The precentral gyrus, you know that. You have the motor cortex. And there is a second motor area in the temporal lobe. So the motor area first is in the precentral gyrus, in the lower one third where the face area is there, which controls the voluntary movements and eye closure from the precentral gyrus. And there is a second motor area in the temporal lobe, according to Snyder and Crosby. It is for eye blink. The routine eye movements is in the precentral gyrus, but eye blink, it's a reflex movement. And this eye blink is in the temporal lobe. And then the emotions are there. So supranuclearly, you have got motor functions. Then you have got blink, which is little different. And then you have got the emotions. The emotional component is in the cingulate gyrus, insula, amygdala, thalamus, medial temporal and supplementary motor area. So multiple areas are concerned with the emotional component. The cingulate gyrus, insular region, amygdala, thalamus, medial temporal region and supplementary motor area. And then upper part of the face has got bilateral control, which has been taught from undergraduate days, all of you know, for voluntary movement, and lower part is contralateral. So this is the central control. You remember that the motor function, voluntary motor function is different, the blink is different, the emotional fibers are different, and the upper part of the face has bilateral control for voluntary movement and lower part has got only contralateral control. So this is central control. So this is the homunculus. You can see that this is the sensory homunculus. This is the motor homunculus and the face is here in the precentral gyrus. Then the corticobulbar fibers from the lower one third of the precentral gyrus reach the corona radiata, genu of the internal capsule, medial part of the cerebral peduncles and reach the pons. So they start from the this area, then they descend through the lower one third, from the lower one third of the precentral gyrus. This is the lower one third of the precentral gyrus. From there, they reach the corona radiata, genu of the internal capsule. That's the corticobulbar fibers in the genu of the internal capsule and medial part of the cerebral peduncle and reaches the pons. On reaching the pons, the fibers decussate to the facial motor nucleus of the opposite side. So they cross over and decussate in the motor fibers of the opposite side. There are two motor nuclei, the dorsal motor nucleus and the ventral motor nucleus. The dorsal motor nucleus has got bilateral control. That is for the upper parts. At this level, the dorsal motor nucleus has got bilateral control and the ventral is only contralateral. So dorsal is bilateral and ventral is contralateral. Then the second group of upper motor fibers are centrally originating extrapyramidal fibers. We know that most of the Parkinsonian patients also show alteration in the facial movement. So this comes from the supplementary motor area. We saw that the emotional fibers come from the supplementary motor area, cingulum, insular region, all these things. So this supplementary motor area, area 6. Centrally originating extrapyramidal system enters into the putamen, tegmentum, and nucleus of the facial nerve. So we saw how the fibers which come from the area 4, they descend through the corona radiata, genu of the internal capsule, reach the facial nucleus in the pons, crossing over the opposite side, dorsal fibers, bilateral and ventral fibers, contralateral. So that is corticospinal. Now you have got the centrally originating extrapyramidal fibers, which come from the area in front of area 4, that is area 6, and originates, and they are the centrally originating extrapyramidal system. It enters into the putamen, tegmentum of the brainstem, and then the nucleus of the facial nerve. So that is how the extrapyramidal fibers reach the facial nerve. Then we have got the second motor area of the temporal lobe. It is the center for blinking. It is a sneeders, so center for blinking. This is the second motor area. You have got the motor area from which the motor fibers are coming, the supplementary motor area from the extrapyramidal fibers are coming, and we have got the second motor area or the temporal lobe from where the blinking fibers are coming. And periodic blinking is centrally located in the brainstem reticular formation and basal ganglia. And unilateral blinking is a learned phenomenon. You train yourself to do. Generally, the naturally present movement is bilateral blinking, which we constantly do. Unilateral blinking is a learned movement. So what is eye blink? Eye blink is a conjugate vertical eye and lid movement at a frequency of 15 to 20 per minute seen in awake persons. It's a conjugate vertical and lid movement. So vertical eye and lid movement at a frequency of 15 to 20, that is very important, per minute seen in awake persons. This can also be a reflex startle response. Some surroundings heard, then also we blink, apart from the routine blinking. Startle response to sudden auditory stimulus modified by emotional state. So few hundred milliseconds after one blink, there is a general inhibition of the blink reflex to acoustic or visual stimulus. So for there is a rest period after a sudden blink is generated. So we might subconsciously use blink as a sort of mental resting point. It is believed to be a mental resting point to briefly shut off visual stimuli and allow us to focus our attention on what we have seen or read. And there is a functional synkinesis between attention, audition, because all this produce blink, attention, audition, vision, and orbicularis oculi. Orbicularis oculi is the one which is the end organ producing the blink, and it can be for mental resting to attend on what you have listened, or to sudden sound, or to sudden visual stimuli. All this blink can be generated. So it is believed that there is a functional synkinesis between the attention, audition, vision, and orbicularis oculi. So here you see the mask-like faces in a patient with extrapyramidal disorder. Centrally originating extrapyramidal fibers are involved, so he is not able to show the normal facial expressions. Here you see a person, he is having a facial palsy on the right side. That is dissociation between the emotional fibers and the motor fiber is a typical feature of upper motor neuron. As you know, when the end organ comes, all of them are coming together. So in the upper motor neuron level, it is like that. So here you see that is the deviation of the left side. But when a joke is said, he is able to make a symmetrical smile. So this is emotional fibers are preserved, motor fibers are paralyzed. This is combined. This is another supranuclear. So first supranuclear, centrally originating extrapyramidal. Here you see only motor and emotion preserved. And here you see combined. Combined also occurs in supranuclear, where both motor and emotional paralysis is happening in this child. So these are all supranuclear various combinations. So supranuclear therefore controls center motor palsy, emotional palsy, combined emotional and motor, and eye blink. So these are the four things which are centrally controlled, for which I have shown examples. So next we will come to nuclear. So supranuclear, very clear, I think. Motor is there, blink is there, extrapyramidal is there, and emotional fibers are there. Then we are coming to the nucleus. We have landed in the pons, where the dorsal fibers are controlling bilateral and ventral fibers are controlling contralateral part. So we have landed in the pons. So nucleus in the pons has got a large motor and a small sensory part. And the motor nucleus has got four horizontal groups. Like in the third, now the Warwick's model is there. Each muscle supplies one nucleus. The facial nerve also has got a four groups of nuclei, which is very relevant in some degenerative diseases. So it will help us to diagnose degenerative disease or a nerve level. So nuclear level, dorsomedial group, intermediate group, ventromedial group, and lateral group. So in the nucleus, we are having four groups. One is the dorsomedial group, second is the intermediate group, third is the ventromedial group, and fourth is the lateral group. The dorsomedial group supplies auricular and occipital branch. So the dorsomedial group of motor fibers in the facial nerve nucleus supplies only the auricular and the occipital belly of the occipital frontalis. So if this is a nuclear lesion, all these will be not affected. Nuclear lesion will affect one group. They can be dissociatedly affected. So dorsomedial group supplies auricular and occipital branch. Intermediate group supplies the frontalis and corrugator. The ventromedial group supplies the platysma. The lateral group supplies the buccinator and other facial muscles. So there are four groups, four distinct groups in the motor nucleus in the pons, and each group supplies individual muscles. So a nuclear paralysis like happening in motor neuron disease or polio that can pick up one group and leave the others. Then only you can say it's a nuclear palsy at the facial nerve nucleus. So this is not a very good picture, I should say, that it is showing the facial nerve there. So in the nuclear part does not contain sensory fibers. All of us know the motor nucleus of the facial nerve goes around the sixth nerve, but it is not having the sensory component at that level. It goes around the sixth nerve nucleus to form the facial colliculus. So in the nuclear part, there is no sensory fibers. It is only motor, and it is in four groups, and each group supplies individual muscles, and it goes around the sixth nerve nucleus to form the facial colliculus. So nuclear lesion, how to diagnose? So as you know, the facial colliculus is there. So sixth and the seventh nerve are together in the nuclear level. So if you have a person who is having sixth and seventh nerve together, and that seventh nerve is not having cauda tympani or greater superficial petrosal or notus tepidus, it is only purely the motor component of the seventh nerve, then it may be nuclear. So nuclear seventh nerve palsy, sixth and seventh nerve together. Sometimes you may have, because the PPRF is nearby, reticular formation, so gaze center, pontine gaze center. So in addition to sixth and seventh nerve, if you have the pontine gaze palsy, that is again favoring a nuclear. So look for a gaze palsy. Then patchy muscle involvement, that as I told you, there are four groups. So one group may be wasted, other group may be normal. That is seen in M1D. And crossed hemiplegia. So you have got the seventh nerve and crossed hemiplegia, Millet-Gubler syndrome. So if that is there, nucleus. So typical feature, supranuclear, we have seen clearly, I think I will be revising it again. A nuclear is sixth and seventh nerve together with or without PPRF. Patchy muscle involvement and crossed hemiplegia for the reasons which I have explained just now. So this is a person with a pontine lesion, and she is having the sixth and the seventh. Sixth is there, seventh is there. So that is a nuclear lesion. So this is another patient. His eye movement video I had, but unfortunately I didn't find time to incorporate that. He had bilateral PPRF involvement. So what happens is a frozen eye in the horizontal plane. The horizontal plane, the eye will not move. It's a frozen horizontal eye. That happens in bilateral PPRF involvement. This is a person with a right facial and a left hemiplegia. So it's a crossed hemiplegia. So right facial and left hemiplegia, crossed hemiplegia. So these are the nuclear lesions. Clearly I have shown this is one nuclear lesion. This is a frozen with PPRF. This is crossed hemiplegia, and this is a buccinator alone. We saw that the lateral most group supplies the buccinator muscle. So her frontalis is all right. You can see the frontalis is all right. Her palpebral fissure is normal, but buccinator is gone. So that is the third feature of. So I have shown all the four features of nuclear level facial palsy. So facial nucleus participates in the corneal reflex. So corneal pain and temperature fibers go through the ophthalmic division of the fifth nerve to the spinal nucleus of the fifth nerve. So that is afferent for the corneal reflex, and then to the ipsilateral seventh nerve nucleus, causing the eyelid to blink. So that's a corneal reflex. And there are central connections between the facial nucleus and the nucleus of the second, third, fourth, sixth, and eighth cranial nerve. These connections coordinate certain reflexes, such as the blink reflex on exposure to strong light or a loud sound. So nuclear part also has got role in corneal reflex, that is by its connections with the fifth nerve, and it is also having a link with various other cranial nerves, second, third, fourth. So bright light, then you can have so sound, all these will produce, affect the blink reflex because of the link, central connection between the facial nerve nucleus and the nuclei of the various other cranial nerves. Next, so supranuclear over, nuclear over. Now we will come to intraaxial fascicular. Intraaxial fascicular means still inside the brainstem, but it has left the nucleus. So intraaxial fascicular means inside the brainstem after it has left the nucleus. So here in the descending part of the motor fibers, nervous intermediates of Ritzberg will join. You know the sixth nerve is there, seventh nerve goes round, forms the facial colliculus, and in the descending limb, the nervous intermediates of Ritzberg will join. And parasympathetic fibers for salivation from the superior salivatory nucleus and lacrimation from the lacrimal nucleus of the pontine tegmentum. So in the descending limb, that is in the intraaxial fascicular part of the seventh nerve, you have the fibers concerned with salivation and lacrimation as well as the sensory fibers. It has preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to submaxillary, pterygopalatine and sphenopalatine ganglia. So in the descending limb, that is in the intraaxial fascicular, just follow me that I am telling you as a template for all cranial nerve localization. So supranuclear is very clear, nuclear is very clear. Now we are coming to the intraaxial fascicular part. There, the nervous intermediates of Ritzberg is joined and the fibers for salivation and lacrimation are also joining. Then you have got the sensory. A small area around the conga of the ear is supplied by the posterior auricular branch of the facial nerve. So that is the somatic sensation. Then special sensations. It provides special taste sensation to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, cauda tympani nerve. And parasympathetic supplies many of the glands of the head and neck, including submandibular, sublingual, salivary gland, nasal, palatine, pharyngeal mucous glands, and lacrimal gland. So in the descending limb, you have got the lacrimal, the secretomotor fibers, and you have got the nervous intermediates, and there is a sensory and the special sensory, all of them are joining in the intraaxial fascicular part. So gustatory afferents end in the nucleus of the tractus solitarius, that the taste afferents. The fibers which carry the taste sensation, they reach the nucleus. They have a different pathway. Even we saw the motor pathway, then taste is different. So gustatory afferents end in the nucleus of the tractus solitarius in the medulla and exteroceptive afferents in the nucleus of the spinal tract of the trigeminal. So that is the routine sensations are in the trigeminal nerve, whereas the taste sensation goes to the tractus solitarius in the medulla. Then the dorsal part of the trigeminal tract supplies fibers that convey cutaneous sensation from the external auditory meatus and skin behind the ear. So that is the sensory somatic sensation, I said, comes through the auricular branch. That is traveling through the trigeminal tract in the dorsal part. And then also then the spinal tract, the sensation from the anterior part of the tongue is going, and the taste sensation from the tongue is going through the nucleus of the tractus solitarius. So in the brainstem, there's a different track for the sensory fibers. One through the trigeminal tract, second through the spinal tract of trigeminal, third through the nucleus of the tractus solitarius. Then after, so that is the intraaxial fascicular. So in the intraaxial fascicular part, the sensory fibers, the secretomotor fibers are joining. And we just briefly saw where they are traveling in the brainstem in a different plane from the motor fibers. Now the nerve is coming out, it is leaving from the pons and entering the cisternal plane. It is entering into the cisternal plane outside the pons. So intraaxial fascicular is over, it is entering into the cisternal plane. In the petrous apex, lies in the Dorello's canal. So when it comes out, you know that there is a petrous apex. The petrous apex, there is a canal called Dorello's canal, closely with the sixth nerve. So here in the petrous apex, Gradini-Ghost syndrome, you might have heard. So there, the petrous apex, the sixth, seventh nerve lies in the Dorello's canal and in close relationship to the sixth, and little more lateral is the fifth. That is the Gradini-Ghost syndrome will be fifth and the sixth, along with or without seventh. So then so it lies in that petrous apex and then comes out and reaches the cerebellopontine angle. So from the intraaxial fascicular part, the seventh nerve escapes into the cisternal plane. It lies in the petrous apex in close association with the sixth nerve and then enters into the cerebellopontine angle. So if it is involved in the petrous apex, it will be affected along with the sixth nerve. Then you know in the cerebellar pontine angle, it will be affected along with the fifth nerve and the cerebellar features. And both these roots enter the internal acoustic meatus. You know that on the inner side of the petrous bone, there is an internal auditory meatus. So it escapes, lies in the Dorello's canal, briefly in the cerebellar pontine angle, and then enters into the internal acoustic meatus in close proximity to the inner ear. The roots leave the internal acoustic meatus and enter into the facial canal. So into the internal auditory meatus it enters and it lies in the facial canal. The canal is an Z-shaped structure which makes this nerve having a longest osseous part. So cisternal, skull base, I was telling, supranuclear, nuclear, intraaxial, fascicular, cisternal, skull base. In the skull base, this is the facial nerve has got the longest intraosseous course, no other cranial nerve, because the petrous bone is very long and the facial canal is inside that. So this cisternal part, you have to remember, in the petrous apex, it can be simple facial nerve or along with sixth nerve, or in the cerebellopontine angle with other features of cerebellopontine angle tumors. Then it enters in the internal acoustic meatus and goes into the skull base or in the osseous part where it is having the longest course. The facial canal. So that is the in the inner ear, you don't bother about all these. So all these structures are there. So here it enters into the internal auditory meatus and goes into the facial canal. So this is the petrous bone. So here this is the petrous bone. This is the internal auditory meatus. It is entering there and it is lying in the facial canal. So the here you are seeing where it is escaping. So here you see that this is the dolichoectasia of the vertebral artery, which is impinging on the facial nerve. These patients present with hemifacial spasms. No? And here you see the schwannoma. This is a, that is the mass you are seeing. And next here on the on this side, you are seeing that neurovascular conflict. No? So you see the neurovascular conflict there. This also present as hemifacial spasm. So here you see a hyperdense nerve, any demyelination. So now you have entered the facial canal, which is having the longest course, about 33 millimeters, it is there in the facial canal. And three important events take place in the facial canal. One, inside the facial canal, here there is a geniculate ganglion. All of us know that geniculate ganglion is there. And it gives off three important branches. In the osseous part, three important branches are given off. One is the greater superficial petrosal nerve. Second is the nerve to stapedius. Third is the caudal tympanum. I know that you know all this. My aim is to tell you all to make a template for all cranial nerves in this way. Then you will very easily know the anatomy. So as I would have told in the previous sessions, neurology is nothing but anatomy, physiology, and some common sense. That is all. It is the most mathematical specialty. No, so you. So I am clearly telling each brain is different. So here it gives rise to these three branches and leaves the skull base between the mastoid and the styloid process. There it gives the posterior auricular branches. And then it enters into the parotid and gives five motor branches in the substance of the parotid gland. So here it is the stylomastoid foramen. It is coming out. No? So a motor and the sensory roots fuse in to form the facial nerve, you know. Next, the nerve forms the geniculate ganglia and then gives rise to the greater superficial petrosal nerve, which is parasympathetic fibers to the mucous glands and lacrimal gland. This is what we test by Schirmer's test that I'll come to later. And next is the nerve to stapedius, which produces hyperacusis when it is paralyzed. And cauda tympani, with special sensory fibers to anterior two-thirds of the tongue and parasympathetic fibers to submandibular and sublingual glands. So these are the three important branches happening inside the facial canal: the greater superficial petrosal nerve for lacrimation, nerve to stapedius for stapedius muscle, and that's the first motor branch of the facial nerve. Which is the first motor branch of the facial nerve is nerve to stapedius. And cauda tympani is special sensory fibers to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue and parasympathetic fibers to the submandibular and sublingual glands. So now we will see what each nerve is doing. The greater superficial petrosal nerve arises just distal to the geniculate ganglia. That is the first branch within the facial canal. It moves in the anteromedial direction, all of you know, and exiting the temporal bone in the middle cranial fossa. Then it travels along the foramen lacerum, joins the deep petrosal nerve. You know, the deep petrosal nerve, which comes along with the carotid artery and forms the nerve of the pterygoid canal. The Vidian's nerve, otherwise the nerve of the pterygoid canal is otherwise called the Vidian's nerve, enters the pterygopalatine fossa and synapses with the pterygopalatine ganglion and provides parasympathetic innervation to the mucous glands of the oral cavity, nose, pharynx, and most important thing which we test is the lacrimal gland. No? So that is the greater superficial petrosal nerve. It joins with the deep petrosal nerve, forms the nerve of the pterygoid canal and descends in the middle cranial fossa to the pterygopalatine fossa and provides innervation to the lacrimal gland. Next is the nerve to stapedius, first motor branch which arises from the facial canal. It passes through the pyramidal eminence to supply the stapedius muscle in the middle ear. Next is the cauda tympani nerve and taste sensation from the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, secretomotor fibers to the submandibular and lingual salivary glands, and general sensation from the anterior two-thirds of the tongue and secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland and different vasodilator fibers to the tongue. So cauda tympani nerve has got four important functions. One is the taste sensation, then secretomotor supply to the various salivary glands, and general sensors. Each one goes through different pathways in the brainstem. But these are the four important functions: taste to the anterior of the tongue, then secretomotor to the salivary glands, then general sensation to the anterior of the tongue, and vasodilator fibers to the tongue. One interesting phenomenon is that the glossopharyngeal nerve, which supplies taste in the posterior one-third of the tongue, and the cauda tympani, which supplies the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, have a seesaw relationship. So that normally it is the anterior part which is sensing most of our nice taste. But when this inhibits the glossopharyngeal, so whenever the cauda tympani is damaged, the glossopharyngeal will become disinhibited and take over the function of the sweet, salt, which is all carried by the anterior two-thirds. So that is why every time when you read neurology, a neurologist, after reading neurology for sometime you become a philosopher and you cannot help being spiritual, because how beautifully God has created balance everywhere. In case you lose your caudal tympani, your glossopharyngeal should take over, no? So like that. So these are the four important functions: taste, special sensation, secretomotor, and vasodilation. Then peripheral connections of the caudal tympani. In the facial canal, it travels across the bones of the middle ear, leaves via the petrotympanic fascia, and reaches the infratemporal fossa. These combine with the lingual branch of the fifth nerve and forms a submandibular ganglion. And branches from this ganglion travel to the submandibular and sublingual salivary glands. The main body of the nerve leaves to innervate the anterior two-third of the tongue. So it joins with the lingual branch of the mandibular division of the fifth nerve. Then you have got the central connections. So central connection, superior salivatory nucleus for the secretomotor fibers. You see, your taste is carried afferent by afferent way, you know that. So it has to go to the center to be sent. So superior salivatory nucleus, the secretomotor fibers, gustatory nucleus in the medulla, that is the solitarius, nucleus solitarius, supply sensory fibers for taste. So secretomotor fibers, which travel through the caudal tympani now, goes to superior salivatory nucleus. The gustatory fibers, gustatory afferents, reach the gustatory nucleus, and then they reach the thalamus, the posterior limb of the internal capsule, and reach the gustatory cortex, which is situated in the insular region. In that gustatory cortex, there are separate group of neurons for salt, separate group of neuron for bitter, sore. So it is clustered neurons in the insular cortex. So salivatory, the secretomotor, we saw four important functions: general somatic sensation, that through the fifth nerve, then taste through the gustatory nucleus to the posterior limb of the internal capsule, thalamus, and the insular cortex. And superior salivatory nucleus carries the secretomotor afferents from the caudal tympani. So this is the taste pathway. As you know, the posterior part by the 10th nerve, and you have got the epiglottis by the 10th nerve, and they all reach together the nucleus of the tractus solitarius, ascent, and goes to the insular region. So three nerves are involved in taste sensation: 7th nerve, the 9th and 10th, 9th and 10th. So 10th here, 9th, they all reach the solitary nucleus, ascent, goes to the thalamus, and then goes to the insular cortex. That is the taste path. So afferent fibers from the anterior two-third of the tongue travel via the lingual nerve to the caudal tympani nerve and then to the gustatory nucleus. Taste fibers from the posterior third of the tongue, the palate, and the palatal arches travel via the glossopharyngeal nerve and the ganglion nodosum and end in the gustatory nucleus. And there are two ascending pathways from the gustatory nucleus, one to the hypothalamus, the other to the thalamus, and then to the gustatory center of the cortex, that is area 43 in the parietal operculum in the insular region, where clustered cells which appreciate each type of sensations are there. So this is the, again showing the 7th nerve going like that, and here it is in the pons. This is the tractus solitarius. Then in the middle ear, the facial nerve lies in a separate canal, the canal of here, and reaches the infratemporal fossa behind the lateral pterygoid muscle and joins the lingual nerve 2 centimeters below the skull base. And it exits through the foramen behind the spine of the sphenoid, that is the stylomastoid foramen. Then the so now it has given all the branches in the facial canal. So it is coming out to the soft tissue plane. So we saw the skull base so far. What happened in the skull base? That is in the facial canal. We saw everything in the skull base. Then it is coming to the soft tissue plane. So in the soft tissue plane, first branch it gives is the stylohyoid branch. Stylohyoid branch of the facial nerve arises before the parotid, just before it enters in the parotid, and supplies the stylohyoid muscle. Stylohyoid muscle is located superior to the posterior belly of the digastric, and it arises from the styloid process of the temporal bone and attaches to the lateral aspect of the hyoid bone. It assists in swallowing action by pulling the hyoid bone in a posterior superior direction. So facial nerve is not only having a role in the oral phase, it is also having a role in the pharyngeal phase of swallowing, but the pharyngeal phase of swallowing is mainly done by the 9th and the 10th nerve. So the facial nerve's function is only synergistic, so it is not mostly symptomatic. So that is the stylohyoid. Next, you have got the digastric. The digastric has, as the name implies, two muscular bellies and pierce the stylohyoid muscle. And it is having an anterior belly which arises from the digastric force of the mandible. The posterior belly arises from the mastoid process of the temporal bone, and the two bellies are connected by an intermediate tendon which is attached to the hyoid bone via a fibrous link. So it depresses the mandible and elevates the hyoid bone along with the stylohyoid. So this anterior belly is denervated by the inferior alveolar branch of the fifth nerve. And the posterior belly of the stylohyoid and posterior belly of the digastric is supplied by the facial nerve. So facial nerve supplies only the posterior belly, anterior belly supplied by the branch of the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve. Then after it exists, it gives the posterior auricular nerve. It supplies the muscles around the ear. This nerve continues anteriorly and inferiorly into the parotid gland, but it does not innervate the parotid gland. Parotid gland is innervated by the glossopharyngeal nerve. So parotid gland, it just lies. It doesn't innervate the parotid gland. Then the terminal branches are temporal branch, zygomatic branch, buccal branch, marginal mandibular branch, and cervical branch. So each branch supplies different muscles. So muscles supplied by the facial nerve, the stapedius muscle, posterior belly of digastric, the stylohyoid, then muscles of facial expression, and the temporal branch innervates the frontalis, orbicularis oculi, and corrugator supercili. Zygomatic branch innervates the orbicularis oculi, zygomaticus major and minor. The buccal branch innervates the orbicularis oris, buccinator, zygomaticus, and risorius. Then the marginal mandibular branch innervates the mandibular muscle, and the cervical branch innervates the platysma. So these are the motor supply of the facial nerve. Starts from the nerve to stapedius, then stylohyoid, digastric, and the muscles of facial expression. Then you have got the platysma, which is a corrugator cutis muscle, which is a skin, supplies the skin of the neck. So what are the function? Frontalis elevates the eyebrows. Orbicularis oculi closes the eyes. Zygomaticus is grinning, corner of the mouth up. And risorius strides smile. And buccinator blowing the cheek. Platysma draws corners of the jaw down to contract the skin of the neck. So taste, you have got the, you know how to test. The tongue should be made dry. It should be brought out. You have to use a filter paper and you have to use a solution. And you put it in the form of a solution, and patient has to identify all this, you know, rinse the mouth thoroughly and repeat the, and before doing the second test setting, you will have to rinse thoroughly and repeat the test on the other side using a different substance. So that is a taste. So taste, you have to test by drying the tongue. Pull out the tongue and put the taste material in the form of a solution, and after you analyze one taste, you will have to wash it up thoroughly, dry again, and use the next taste, and each side should be tested separately. Next is speech, swallowing, and spitting. So speech, what happens? Flaccid dysarthria of labial type, because orbicularis, so oris, PB, so labial type of dysarthria. Then oral phase of swallowing. Food leaks from the angle of the mouth, stays in the gingivobuccal gutter due to buccinator, and chewing is assisted by the stylohyoid and posterior belly of digastric. Then cannot spit or blow the cheek. So this is function in speech, swallowing, and spitting. Then in the element level can be intracranial. So human level we saw first. Then the element level, the element facial palsy can be intracranial in the facial canal. So intracranial means in the intraaxial fascicular onwards it is lumen. Then in the facial canal, in the stylomastoid foramen, in the substance of the parotid gland and terminal branches. So how to differentiate EMN from LMN? All of you know very well. Still, I will repeat. EMN upper face is paired. LMN whole face is affected. And EMN, there can be dissociation between motor and emotional. Whereas in LMN, there is no such differentiation possible. And facial reflexes are preserved in EMN, but they are depressed in LMN. And in EMN, you can have hemiplegia, but in LMN, hemiplegia is not a component. And Bell's phenomena is absent in EMN, Bell's phenomena is present in LMN. There is no hyperacusis because all these branches are coming different pathway. As we have seen, how each one is going through different pathway. So this EMN will not affect the navtostapedius, cauda tympani, greater superficial petrosal. So these are affected means it is LMN. Then facial reflexes are brisk, they are impaired in LMN. Then bilateral EMN and bilateral LMN, dissociation between emotional and motor fibers, if it is present, it is EMN. In bilateral LMN, it is always associated only. And tears, taste, hearing is not affected in EMN, but if they are affected, it is LMN. Facial reflexes are brisk in EMN, it is not brisk in LMN. And bipyramidal signs are usually present in bilateral EMN. In bilateral EMN, Bell's phenomena is not going to help you. So when there is a bilateral EMN and LMN differentiation, you should not mention Bell's phenomena because it is going to be affected symmetrically, it is not going to help you. So this is an 18-year-old boy, symptomatic for 8 years. He signs spasticity all four limbs, bilateral LMN 7th, bilateral 12th, bilateral 9th, 10th. So facioalon type of Andrew Hansel disease. So this is all things are involved. Bilateral, this is a EMN. You can see this boy is having decreased facial movements and he is able to open the eye, but still you can see that the facial movements are not at all seen, but when he is asked to smile, you see, there's a dissociation between motor and emotional. Emotional part is expressed very well. So this is previously I showed you unilateral, this is bilateral. So this is facial type of MND. This is a bilateral LMN facial palsy. You can see the Bell's phenomena, but asymmetry will not be visible, but this person has got mild asymmetry. Then sensory component, the dorsal part of the trigeminal tract supplies fibers that convey cutaneous sensation from the external auditory matrix and skin behind the ear. So that is a sensory component. Now how to check in individual muscles. This is orbicularis oris. You tell the patient to close the lips or blow or sip from a straw. No? This is buccinator, making the cheek, no? And this is platysma. Tell the patient to push down the lower jaw and look at the muscle on this side you are not seeing, no? And then this is a checking for Bell's phenomena. You can see that the eye on the right side has rolled up. And this is another boy who had so many cranial nerves involvement, 12th also, hemibasal syndrome. So how to check? You have to check for forehead wrinkling, eye closure, you have to check like this power. This is orbicularis oris, and this is rhizorius, zygomaticus, and so that is how you check. Then elevate both eyebrow, unable to elevate eyebrow on the right side. So subtle facial. So how are you going to diagnose very subtle facial palsy? When it is full, it is very easy. So you look for incomplete burying of eyelashes. So tell the patient to screw the eye. The eyelashes are not buried on one side as much as on other side. That's a subtle facial palsy. And reduced blink rate. Mild asymmetry in the palpebral fissure. Then there is something called Barbara Wattenberg sign. You put your fingers on the patient's closed eye. Normally, all of us, there will be mild curing of the muscles. That curing movement will be not appreciated on the side of the facial palsy. And when the eye is elevated slowly, you tell the patient to flex the neck like this. Then slowly, straight forward gaze, palpebral fissure appears symmetrical. But when you do this, multiple writing reflexes come into play. So halfway through, you will find that there is a mild asymmetry in the palpebral fissure. When the patient is slowly raising the head from the flex portion, that is a von Graffy sign. So these are features of subtle facial palsy: burying of eyelashes, reduced blink rate, mild asymmetry in the palpebral fissure, then reduced squaring of the orbicularis oculi muscles when you put your fingers on that, and when you slowly lift the neck from the flex posture, mild asymmetry in the palpebral fissure will be seen. So these are some questions you ask, that and all, you know, whether it came suddenly, whether it is progressing, is it recurrent, what are all the associated symptoms, medical histories, all this. Millet-Gobler syndrome, you know, 6th and 7th with crossed hemiplegia. Then how we are going to differentiate chronic facial palsy. So chronic facial palsy can manifest as hemifacial spasm. Then prominent, you see that the nasolabial fold will be obliterated in an acute facial palsy. But in a chronic facial palsy, the nasolabial fold becomes prominent. Then ipsilateral deviation. Normally it is contralateral deviation, but chronic facial palsy due to contracture, there is ipsilateral facial deviation. But how to know that ipsilateral deviation is not due to contralateral paralysis? The power on that side will be reduced. Then you can have other features of faulty re-innervation, like crocodile tears and reverse Marcus gun phenomena. So chronic facial palsy, hemifacial spasm, prominent nasolabial fold as against obliteration of the nasolabial fold, and ipsilateral deviation with reduced power, then other features of faulty re-innervation. So here you can see the left palpebral fissure is narrow. That is due to contracture. So normally it should be wide. When it becomes chronic, it becomes reverse, due to contracture of the orbicularis oculi muscle. But you can see that there is ipsilateral facial deviation. This also, there was narrowing of the palpebral fissure, but power is less. The eyelashes are jutting out. You can see the eyelashes jutting out. That indicates the power is poor. Here there is prominent nasolabial fold and ipsilateral facial deviation. And there you see hemifacial spasm. You see the muscle in spasm on that side. Then you can see the crocodile tears, repair by the fifth nerve to the greater, so greater superficial petrosal branch is damaged. So this branch is innervated by the fifth nerve, which is in the cavum trigeminal adjoining. So when the greater superficial petrosal nerve is damaged, fifth nerve tries to help it recover. Then what happens? Fifth nerve is chewing. So whenever you are chewing, tears will come. So that is crocodile tears. And reverse jaw winking. Yes, this is repaired by the motor fifth to the ocular muscles. So when the motor fifth muscles try to repair the ocular muscles, when you open your jaw, the eye also will close, or it can open or close, both reverse jaw winking or jaw winking. And you can have gustatory sweating due to repair mechanisms with the autonomic fibers. So here you can see.
Very disturbing. So fast.
Okay, and the fifth nerve is regenerating in the lacrimal nerve. It is not. It's very difficult. You will not be able to do all this.
You can see the tears there in the right eye. No?
Though it's a matter of 5 to 10 seconds, but when I am eating for a long time, for a lunch
or
dinner.
You can see the tears in the right eye.
Yes.
It is there. It can clearly make out. And gradually it will drop.
Greater superficial petrosal nerve, nerve of that,
so this will be reverse jaw winking. Same person.
Please open.
You can see when he opens his mouth, the eye is closing. So depending on the location, etiology will change that and all. I am sure you know that skull buoys fractures can produce facial nerve. Then geniculate herpes produce Ramsay-Hunt syndrome, tumors in the cerebellopontine angle and tumors of the parotid gland. And these are the various causes. These are all too familiar. My purpose of this session is to tell you that each cranial nerve, you should make your own template. Unfortunately, this template is not there, even though all this is there in the books. You have to read and make your own template. So localization of any cranial nerve becomes very easy. And you have got Malkerson-Rosenthal syndrome. It's an inherited disorder where recurrent facial palsy with facial swelling and fissured tongue. And you can get alternate facial palsy, facial edema, granulomatous keloiditis, and this is osteopetrosis, where the foramina become narrow in facial nerve. Mobius syndrome demonstrates bilateral facial palsy often associated with other cranial nerve involvement. Then you've got golden heart syndrome, oculo-auriculo-vertebral dysplasia, bony dysplasia. So there is a facial nerve palsy. They can have other bony changes. And dictums, combined involvement of orbicularis oculi. Orbicularis oculi is applied by the seventh nerve. And levator is applied by the third nerve. So if these two muscles are involved, it is myasthenia gravis. It's a clue for you. So if there is an orbicularis oculi, one thing, it can be a nuclear involvement, I told. But that will not involve the levator. So if there is an orbicularis oculi clubbed with the involvement of the levator, which is supplied by the third nerve, you have to think of myasthenia. In myasthenia, you get plus minus sign. You close one eye, the opposite eye will open. So that is myasthenia, RNS. So this is another myasthenia before and after neostigmatitis. And this is showing the course of the seventh nerve. You can see the seventh nerve there. So tumor. Then you can check the blink rate. As I told, you can check the blink rate. It will be reduced. Schirmer's test, a 0.5 millimeter filter. Schirmer's test 1 and 2 is there. One, you check, put a filter paper, allow it to hang, and you look for the tear column at the end of 5 minutes. It is usually 15 millimeter. If it is less on one side, it indicates greater superficial petrosal nerve is involved. Schirmer's 2 is, you do the nasal stimulation and then look for the secretion. Then you test your taste in the antitooth of the tongue and you ask for hyperacusis. And stepedial reflex is a method to document hyperacusis. That is electroacoustic emittance audiometer is used to find out, confirm that there is hyperacusis. Then blink reflex, you know that blink reflex is checked by stimulating the supraorbital nerve. And it goes to the trigeminal nerve. That's the ophthalmic division. The fifth nerve goes to the trigeminal nerve. Main sensory nucleus in the pons, then nucleus of the spinal tract in the lower pons and medulla. And through a series of interneurons in the pons and lateral medulla, the nerve impulse reaches the ipsilateral and contralateral facial nucleus, from which the efferent signals travel along the facial nerve bilaterally. So this blink reflex can be elicited in the electrophysiology lab. Then how are you going to grade the facial palsy? That is House-Brackmann's facial paralysis rating scale. It is normal or slight weakness, subtle. I have told how to check mild to moderate weakness, mild flickers only, or complete paralysis, no weakness at all, no power at all. So this is the grading is important to prognosticate. Sometimes the patients will improve and they may refuse to accept because I said it is a smiling nerve. If the smile is not all right, the patient will be unhappy. So if they are not recovering to the extent they want, they may blame us. So it is important to grade it on admission itself so that you can tell them that they have in fact improved. So facial nerve is a very interesting nerve. Disability leaves a lot of psychological problems because as I said, it's a smiling nerve and consequence as the smile becomes altered. So, okay. So this is just to tell you that ours is a very great land. We should be grateful for everything that God has given us in the most beautiful way. The most common nerve, which all of us think we know, has so much of information. So each nerve is for 10 genmas to learn. And each small, small thing is so much. And what nature gives us is enormous. What nature has given us is enormous. And we are the people who lived with nature, always respected nature. We loved nature. And these are the mantras in the ancient India where stepping on the floor, you thank Mother Earth. We have forgotten all those things. So we should start. We are young people and the young people should understand that nature has given us so much. And it is not that we have learned anything, not even a small fraction of it we have not learned. So learn to be grateful for all that nature has given us. So at the end of our journey through life, we would have not killed our Janma with ego. Instead, in humility and humbleness, we would have served our motherland. No? So thank you. Okay. So any questions? This is just, I know all of you know all these things. So just to make you understand that, this is how exactly my template of supranuclear, nuclear, intra-axial, which I always taught my students, can be clearly traced in any cranial nerve so that you have very good localization of the cranial nerve anatomy and anatomy gives you the pathology. Any questions? Am I audible or what?
Audible.
Oh, okay. So any questions you can ask me? Was it useful?
Yes, ma'am.
Why very fragile voice you are telling?
Very useful, madam.
What happened?
It is very useful, madam. The approach like that approach, I think many times like you have discussed in the case presentations and all, the orientation to every cranial nerve. I think that is more than that. I think that approach, I think, will help us to remember all the nerves also.
Like, all the cranial nerves other than the first and the second, you can trace them through this course. That will help you to exactly put it where it is affected. Then you know how, where to investigate and what is the pathology. All Bell's palsy do not need MRI. Many patients with Bell's palsy come with MRI. MRI involves cost, no. So finally, patient will not have money to buy steroids. No? So it is very important. When you think it's a cerebellopontine angle tumor, when you think it's a brainstem glioma, and when you think it's a Bell's palsy. So very simple nerve, but I think I have carried you through various planes and you now understand what I always insist, these planes is very important. I think so. Any doubts you have, you ask me. Otherwise, you are tired, huh? All of you became very tired.
No.
Okay. If there are no questions, we'll close. Questions are there, huh?
Madam, one doubt, madam. Can it be like initially the lesion starts off like an element like lesion, ma'am?
Hmm.
Like initially the patient, maybe only the Bell's phenomenon is present, but still the patient is able to, the wrinkling is still preserved in the early stage. Can that be like that possible?
See, if Bell's phenomena is there, it is always LMN. If Bell's phenomena is there, there is no question at all about LMN because as I would have told in some classes before, Bell's phenomena is due to physiological synkinesis between the two muscles, not movement. LMN means always movement paralysis. LMN means muscle paralysis. So only when muscle is involved, Bell's phenomena can manifest. So it is between two muscles, orbicularis oculi and superior rectus. Superior rectus is supplied by the third nerve. Orbicularis oculi is supplied by the seventh nerve. So they are united in a synkinetic, physiological synkinesis movement. when it is broken by weakness of one muscle, the other muscle takes over. So if you have Bell's palsy, you can be, if you have Bell's phenomena, even if it is very subtle, if Bell's phenomena is demonstrable, it is only a lemon. Is that the question you asked? So it can involve any branch, you know, it is having upper branches are involved. It can manifest with a apparently spared lower part. Or you have got conditions like Hansen's disease, where only some branches get involved. So in those situations, it can be only one branch. Other divisions may not be showing the full-fledged facial nerve weakness. But Bell's phenomena is there means there is no quarry at all. If Bell's phenomena is there, it is LMN only.
Because I had this doubt because like recently there was one patient in COVID, madam.
Hmm.
He had like this, only the Bell's phenomenon was there and the upper part of the face was still spared.
It so is possible.
Yes.
It is possible. And even then I told terminally five branches.
Five.
And those branches can be incompletely involved. But if Bell's phenomenon is there, it is not at all inside the brainstem or in the cortex. It is not an evolving stroke. Over, huh? Should we close?
Yes, ma'am. I think there are no more doubts on YouTube, also no doubts, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much, madam, for spending your precious time with all of us.
No, it is my
like every time.
As I told, no. You see, it is I am a retired person, and if I am using my time for you, it is my blessing, my life on this earth also. I may not get another janma. I don't know whether we will walk on this earth once again to carry out our karmas. We don't know. So for that, you are giving me an opportunity only. But I feel that clinical case discussions will be helping you more than theory, which this you read braces, all these points are there. Only thing you will have to make an extract and put it in this template. That is all. But case discussion, each case is unique. So that is why I think case discussion is better. But this small part, when you are unable to get a case, I will cover up. But just inform me the previous day whether you are having any case or not, so that I will put some topic for you.
Yes, ma'am. Two questions are there, ma'am.
Yes.
How to explain facial palsy in lateral medullary syndrome?
You see, supposing you are having facial palsy in lateral medullary syndrome, it is not a classical pica syndrome. You see, pica supplies only medulla, whereas facial pulse, facial nerve is in the pons. But I am sure you know that in 1/3 of patients, there is no pica. Posterior inferior cerebellar artery is not there in 1/3 of patients. Instead, posterior inferior cerebellar artery, the tributary is only the vertebral artery. So in those patients whose pica syndrome is a clinical syndrome, but pica territory is maintained by the vertebral artery and not pica, those patients, the infarct extends to the pons. So if somebody with all other features of a pica syndrome is showing some facial nerve palsy, then even without examining, even without doing an MRA, you can tell that this particular patient's lateral medulla is supplied by the vertebral artery, not pica. That is how you get facial palsy. Clear, huh? Is my, am I answering?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Understood, no?
Yes, ma'am. One more question is, what? No, nervous intermedius of Risberg carries what fibers, Devash?
Nervous intermedius of Risberg carries fibers for the taste, fibers for lacrimation, fibers for salivation, and the sensory fibers. Any other question?
One question. How to examine or find out when patient is having bilateral LMN facial palsy?
bilateral element facial palsy, I showed one face, no? So bilateral element facial palsy will be a frozen face. There will be neither motor movement nor emotional movement. The facial reflexes will be depressed. Bilateral element, depending on the level, cauda tympani, nerve to step medius, or greater superficial petrosal may or may not be involved. But what you find is completely frozen face, both emotional and motor is not there. Corneal reflex, conjunctival reflex is absent. Patient cannot chew, cannot blow the cheek, cannot close the eyes completely. Bell's phenomena, as I told, is asymmetrical uprolling of the eye. In one side will be definitely element. But when it is bilateral element, on both sides the rolling up may be there. So that asymmetry cannot be demonstrated. That is why it becomes less useful. But other features, both emotional and motor paralysis, corneal reflex is impaired, conjunctival reflex is impaired, and other branches may or may not be involved depending on the level in which it is involved. Usually it is not associated with the long tracts unless it is Guillain-Barré syndrome, where you have radiculoneuropathies distally. Any other question, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, madam.
Thank you. So shall we close?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you so much, madam. I think always, whenever we listen to you, our love for neurology also increases. And you realize
love for God should improve. Love for your country should improve. That is what I want. You see, neurology is nothing but spirituality. Every nerve tells you a beautiful designer has designed us. One. Second, you are learning from the money of the people of this country. And you have a lot to give back to your country. Don't run away to another country. Our short life, whatever you accumulate materially, you are not going to carry to the other world. But what did you give back matters when Yama is asking. What did you give back to your country? Very, very important. So these are the two things I wanted to learn from my classes. If anybody has difference of opinion, I am sorry, but I feel that for the small body and for small belly that we have in this country, we can make enough. There is no need to run away anywhere and gather materially and tell that I will serve later. We do not know whether the time will exist for us. Tomorrow we are going to be alive or not, nobody knows. So whatever available time should be used for useful activity which nobody can take off from you when you leave this world. That is what I want you to learn. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, madam.
Thank you. We'll close.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. If possible, take case next class or world case which you have presented to your teachers, you take.
Yes, madam.
It's not there, it's not there, you tell. Not there, but inform me the 1 or 2 days early.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.